Okay, yeah, I'll begin now then. Welcome everybody to today's seminar. Just as a reminder that there will be time for questions at the end of the talk. So if you have any questions during the seminar, please type them into the Q&A box. Okay, great. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Donovan German. Dr. German received his undergraduate degree in marine science from the University of San Diego. He then received his master's in biology studying digestive physiology of fishes at CSU Fullerton. For his doctoral studies, Dr. German investigated the nutritional physiology of Amazonian wood-eating catfishes at the University of Florida. Dr. German then won a University of California President's postdoctoral fellowship to study microbial bio-geochemistry at UCI, where he went on to become an assistant professor in 2011. He is now an associate professor, chair of graduate admissions, and the diverse educational community and doctoral experience mentor for the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology. Dr. German studies nutritional physiology, spanning from the molecular to the whole organism level, and students in his lab are currently investigating digestion and energetics in the face of challenges of diet variation, pollution, and sedimentation. Today, he will be presenting his work on digestive physiology across taxa in his talk entitled Unlocking the Mysteries of the Inner Tube of Life, a Gut-Eyed View of Nutritional Ecology. So please welcome, please join me in welcoming Dr. German.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the invitation to speak today. I haven't been to Bodega in some time. I've been there once, 1997. So my wife was there, she was my girlfriend at the time, taking the marine ecology class. So I went to visit a couple times that summer, and she got to work on a giant Pacific octopus while she was there. And so it was really like a seriously memorable experience for both of us, was being able to interact with this amazing octopus across that summer. So anyway, I really appreciate the opportunity to interact. And yeah, I'm gonna talk about the gut-eyed view of nutritional ecology. And definitely, you know, thinking about how organisms relate to their environment through what they eat and how they digest it. All right, there we go. I'm going to start with my acknowledgments up front because I don't know if, you know, at the end of the talk they get rushed. So I have a whole slew of people that have contributed to the work over the years. We've been funded through lots of different agencies, and there's just been a lot of folks involved. See a lab photo from a few years ago in the middle there. And, you know, we don't take ourselves that seriously because that's a bearded dragon on Beck's leg right there wearing a bow tie. So sort of serious and silly at the same time. But everyone on the right are my current graduate students, and I will share who they are shortly. So what kind of informs kind of the questions we're interested in and what we do in the lab, I think, comes from this basic statement from Bill Karasov and Carlos Martinez del Rio's book from 2007, which is that among physiological processes, those that influence resource use are the most likely to influence an animal's behavior, its population dynamics, role in biotic communities, and its contribution to ecosystem fluxes. So that's a lot of stuff, right? There's a lot going on there. And it is true that almost all those things will be influenced by what they eat and how they digest it. And it's pretty crazy how much how they digest stuff is completely ignored within studies. So if we take an organism like this bonnethead shark, and we say, okay, it's gotta do a lot of different things. It needs to grow, it needs to metabolize, of course, it needs to generate ATP. And of course, it's going to be involved with all the redox reactions that it does. So it's going to consume oxygen, give off CO2, all those good things. It needs to move, right? It needs to move in order to avoid being eaten. It needs to move in order to be able to eat, find mates, all those things. So of course, foraging comes to mind there. It needs to locate and obtain food. Of course, it needs to avoid being eaten, and it needs to reproduce. So all those things together, right, mean that this animal needs to do a lot of things. And the thing that kind of fuels it all are the fact that it requires, as a heterotrophic organism, requires nutrients and energy from its environment. And the only way it can actually gain all of that is, of course, through the gut, that inner tube of life. And that's why we focus on this, is because this inner tube of life really allows us to do everything we do. right? And so we need a gut that functions well and one that matches the kind of challenges that are presented to us from our environments. So in my lab, we kind of have three main pillars of topics that we are investigating and have investigated over the years. So we have digestion and metabolism is kind of a key pillar. Microbiome has definitely become really important over the last few years. And toxins and stress, which is relatively more recent. So just to kind of fill in who's done what. So for digestion and metabolism, we definitely work, as the introduction said, from the molecular to the whole animal level. And so that spans a lot of different techniques. And so we've done this with abalone. And so this is Newton Hood on the left. And everyone knows Alyssa Frederick on the right, because she's up there at Bodega. And so both of them work on abalone and think about these things relating to abalone production and disease, really. We also work on sharks and lizards. That's Smith Lee on the left and Beck Worley on the right. I just say Dr. Smith Lee and Dr. Worley and Dr. Frederick because they've all finished out of my lab. Then Michelle Herrera on the left and Dr. Joseph Eros on the right worked on fishes. So we've worked on a lot of different organisms, right, in terms of thinking about digestion and metabolism and what that means for those organisms. In terms of microbiome, getting into the diversity of microbes and also how they function. Matea Jokic is starting to work on this in fishes in the lab. And Karina Rocco-French is working on this with in relation to toxins and stress in echinoderm larvae. And Samantha Lee and Michelle Herrera also worked on this in sharks and fish as well. So hopefully if I have time, I'm gonna be sharing some of Michelle's work on fish microbiomes. And I should say, we've also done a bit of work with abalone microbiomes as well. And finally, with toxins and stress, thinking about the kind of the whole organism, whether it's their just the host or the host plus their microbes, so the holobiont response. So Nefertiti Smith-Christman is working on the effects of sedimentation in zebrafish as a model. Karina and Matea are both working on how different stressors affect the organism and how it might be mediated through their microbiome. And Alyssa and Newton will also be incorporating aspects of microbiome in their work on toxins, or in this case, more about stress, the global change, right? And so kind of thinking about how the organisms are dealing with different stressors that can arise, especially with a warming world. And in fact, Alyssa and I were working on a grant proposal today on this very topic. So lots of different things going on, but you can see kind of each fits in these kind of pillars of what we do. So because the work today is going to focus more on fishes, I would do want to come to this point of why the heck do we study fish? And so the main reason I got interested in fish, well, for one, you know, being a marine biology major as an undergrad draws me to the water. But when you really start looking at guts and thinking about digestive physiology, the things we know the most about are cows, chickens, pigs, rodents, and humans. Right. And that those animals right there do not represent the diversity of feeding and digestion that are out there, especially among vertebrates. So when you start looking at fishes, that's where the action is, right, in terms of all the variation that's there in different types. So on the top left here, we have a wrasse, a carnivorous wrasse. They're stomachless. They literally don't have a gastric stomach. So that's their whole gut right there. It's just an intestine. Right. So we contrast that with an angelfish here that has a stomach with pyloric ceca, a super long intestine, and then a hindgut chamber where there's microbes to help ferment algal components. And you have another stomachless herbivore here. This is the butterfish from New Zealand. Again, stomachless, but a huge gut, and they have a lot of fermentation going on. And of course, my favorite are the loricrea catfishes that have gut lengths that are 25 times longer than their body. It's like a ball of yarn when you open up their gut and look at it relative to their body size. So there's a lot of variation going on there. And these are detritivores, these loricrea catfishes. So fish are great to start getting into what are the general principles that really drive digestion and like what are the rules of the game. I think this is the best way to kind of do that is to have a lot of the variation captured by the different types of guts we can encounter. So that's why I'm really drawn to working with fishes. So a good example to start with is the curious case of the Whittington catfishes. This is work I did for my PhD And in fact, I can stand up and show you a wood-eating catfish. I have one right here in my hand. If you can look in the, you can see their teeth are really meant for gouging, and you can see in the images here what their teeth look like. And they actually do chew on wood, which I'm also holding up. You can see they actually do gouge the heck out of it. And so they're really neat, and work up to the point that I started working on them suggested, oh man, they're probably digesting wood because they have so much wood in their guts. But again, the gut-eyed view suggests we need to actually look at what the gut is doing. So I'm gonna present just a couple pieces of data from that. And there's a good image also of what wood looks like in nature that they've been chewing on. So I'll start by thinking about the enzymes that are in the gut, right? Digestion itself is a chemical process. You have to have the enzymes to break down substrates for the host to be able to gain anything from them, right? So we'll start here by comparing amylase and cellulase activities in their guts. So we have four different species on the x-axis, their enzyme activity on the y-axis. And the wood eaters are here. So this is Pinnacle, there's two Pinnacle here and then Hypostomus here. So these two and the far right one are the actual wood eaters. So first of all, amylase is super high, right, compared to cellulase. Okay, cellulase is literally along that x-axis. If we zoom in on that, you can see they do have some. But what I want you to look at is that y-axis, right? We're talking about five orders of magnitude greater ability to break down soluble carbohydrates compared to the cellulose itself. So they really aren't very good at digesting the cellulose, the major component of the wood that they're consuming. They're really good at digesting the soluble stuff, okay? And so one thing to keep in mind here is they're eating decaying wood. It's already being broken down by microbes, right? So that's really what they're going after. They're going after the microbes and the stuff the microbes are already making available to them. They're not digesting wood like a termite or something. Again, when you look at their gut, super long, thin-walled, when you see a gut like that, that means they probably eat a lot and pass it through the gut quickly. If microbes were going to be involved, we would see evidence of that. Probably with gut morphology, remember that angelfish that had a big hindgut chamber, something like that, you know, like a large intestine, they don't have that, right? And so when you start looking at how fast the stuff moves through their gut, it moves through in less than 4 hours. So it's like a meter an hour, so how fast stuff is flying through their gut. If you and I have transit times of a meter an hour, we're very sick, okay? So it's not, that's really quickly, but it means they're just passing the stuff through quickly and going after the easy stuff. And when you look at cellulose digestibility, it's about 23%, and they have very low levels of fermentation, showing the microbes aren't really playing a huge role in digestion. So with all of that, right, so this kind of view of taking their digestive physiology and feeding into account, we come to a very different conclusion than just looking at gut contents. Gut contents say, yeah, they eat a lot of wood. But by looking at the physiology and what they're able to assimilate and whatnot, we can come to a very different conclusion that they're not digesting wood. They're really going after the microbes that are in the wood matrix. Okay, and we couldn't have gotten to that point without really diving into the gut itself, hence the gut-eyed view. So in this journey today, I wanna try to make it through these three. I'm gonna start with talking about bonnethead omnivory, which is a fun, exciting topic out of our lab with the bonnethead shark. Then I'll get into the physiological genomics of kind of digestion in prickleback fishes, which are actually really common up there at Bodega. And then finish off with some microbiome and gut function. So I'll start by thinking about the bonnethead. And so I want you to listen to that. Think about, what do you think about with this particular type of music? What comes to mind? Perhaps something more like this, right? We think of Jaws, we think of a meat eater of some sort. I'm not saying man eater, I'm not that bad with sharks, but you know, an aggressive predator. We're not necessarily thinking of this, right? Thinking of a grazer of some sort, or even an animal that would eat plants at all. But in fact, the bonnethead shark does ingest a lot of seagrass. So when you look at the bonnethead, it's a very common member of the Gulf of Mexico, Atlantic coasts. It lives in seagrass meadows, amongst other places. And this paper came out when I was finishing my grad work at Florida, showing that the bonnethead shark in certain populations in the Gulf of Mexico actually ate a lot of seagrass. In fact, juveniles had up to 62% of their gut content mass composed of seagrass, whereas adults were about 40%. And so at the time it was like, it's just incidental. They're not really digesting it at all. They're sharks, right? Sharks are carnivores. There's no way they're getting anything out of that. But I was really curious about it. And so when you start looking at the gut of a shark, and the bonnethead in particular, you can see it is not very long. Remember how long that Loriacrea gut was? The boom, really long thing. Pretty straightforward. They have a proximal intestine. They do have a spiral intestine, right? This region here, when you look at a CT scan, this is one of Samantha's CT scans of the spiral intestine. You can see that the gut surface area gets really high in that gut region. So it's they are making up for that shorter gut with the spiral, but that's about it, right? Otherwise, we consider shark guts to be pretty geared towards a high quality, kind of high protein diet. So they have a shorter gut, and they tend to have lower microbial abundance and diversity than animals eating more plant material. So how the heck can a bonnethead shark be digesting seagrass? That is a good question. This paper came out in 2011, same with Dana Bethea also as the lead author. This is looking at the stable isotopes, comparing bonnethead sharks in the gray with Spherina luminae, which is a closely related scallop hammerhead in the black circles. And one thing that really jumps out, right, is that the gray circles on average are much lower in terms of nitrogen signature than the black circles. And they're also a little bit more enriched on the carbon side of things. Both of those imply a more of a seagrass meadow kind of feeding strategy for the bonnethead, and maybe even imply they might be digesting some of that seagrass because they're definitely eating at a lower trophic level than this closely related hammerhead. And I will back up and say that the bonnethead is itself the smallest of the hammerhead sharks. So it's part of the hammerhead family. So that work really got me talking to Yanni Papastamatou, who's now a faculty member at Florida International University. Yanni is a card-carrying shark biologist, right? He does, as the picture entails, like hardcore shark work, tagging sharks, going down to like 200 feet and doing crazy stuff with sharks. So real shark biologist. And so he and I start talking about it. Like, we need to work on the guts of bonnetheads and get into what's going on, because they might actually be able to digest seagrass. So he sent me some tissues, and we worked through that with an undergrad in the lab, Parth Javeri, and we did come up with very interesting data that suggested they might be able to do this, because it looks like they have microbial enzymes in their hindgut to help them break down components of seagrass. So it's probably worth looking at. And so that's when Samantha Lee came in the lab and started working on this particular project to kind of advance further, right? To really get into the nitty gritty, is can these sharks do it? So she was able to travel to Miami to work at FIU at their Biscayne Bay campus, which is right there. It's a marine lab right on the water. So it gives us access to flow through seawater and everything that we would need. So she went ahead of time, collected seagrass, and got some sharks. And what she did is she actually grew the grass ahead of time outdoors, right, in a tank. And she was putting in 13C labeled sodium bicarbonate into the seawater. And what that means is the bicarb equilibrates and this becomes CO2, right? And as the seagrass photosynthesizes, it uses that CO2 and incorporates the labeled carbon into the tissues of the grass. And it worked really well. We created some very labeled grass. So we're able to generate a food source. We were able to trace as the animal's eating it to see if they're able to assimilate the carbon from that source. So, just kind of reminding everybody of that general equation that CO2 plus water ends up as bicarb. It can go back the other way. So by adding extra bicarb, we were generating CO2 in that system that was 13C labeled. So the sharks themselves were held, in a different enclosure, not with the labeled water at all, with seawater, flowing through from Biscayne Bay. And so what we made for them were called inverted sushi rolls. They look like this. So they were 90% by mass seagrass, so in the middle. On the outside was a sheath of squid. And that squid was enough to entice them to go ahead and eat it in the lab. Because keep in mind, they might ingest up to 60% seagrass, but it doesn't mean that's the only thing they eat, right? Really, they're going after inverts. They eat a lot of crustaceans and other inverts. So putting the squid on there is incentivizing them to eat this in the lab. and I don't know if this is going to play. It's kind of acting up earlier, but it was just a video of them feeding on it, and I'll have to share it afterwards. At any rate, we got them to eat this diet over several weeks in the lab. Sam collected fecal material and looked at digestibility, right? Looking at what goes in versus what comes out. And in terms of organic matter, the seagrass digestibility was about 51%. And you compare that with green sea turtles that are herbivorous and eat the same types of seagrass. When they're juveniles, they're down about 33%, so roughly a third of the organic matter. But by the time they're adults, they're doing really well. Again, 3/4 of the organic matter. Well, our bonnetheads, the adult sharks, are right in the middle, right? They look like an omnivore, right, in terms of their ability to digest organic matter from this seagrass-rich diet. So they got about half of what was there. That's pretty telling. And that's about spot on with us, right? We get about half of the more refractory material in our diet. When you look at, again, their ability to break down what's in their food, digestive enzymes become key. And so we look at digestive enzymes along the gut. We can see amylase activity levels are fairly elevated in the spiral intestine, not statistically so compared to the proximal intestine, but kind of the main point there isn't so much the changing along the gut, it's how high the activity levels are. Because when we compare this to other fishes, for example, prickleback fish, omnivores are about there with that purple line, whereas carnivores are down there with the red line. So they're up there with other omnivores, like known omnivorous fish, right? And so they have these elevated amylase, which suggests, okay, they can at least probably break down the more soluble parts, the starches, the sucroses, things like that, that are present in seagrasses, okay? And so they have the enzymatic data and the organic matter digestibility to support that. Now, what about the fiber, right? Seagrass is like 60% fiber. So it has a lot of cellulose, a little bit of lignin in there. So what about that stuff? So we looked at neutral detergent fiber, which is kind of the combination of cellulose and hemicellulose, and compared that with other known examples where carnivores were fed a plant diet, and we looked but other scientists did, looked at their digestibility. And so you can see collared lizards eating flowers had about 32% digestibility of the fiber component. Pandas, I know we think of them as lovely herbivores, but really they're not good at digesting fiber. And there's great data now calling them macronutrient carnivores because they are in a carnivorous clade otherwise, right? So they eat leaves and shoots of bamboo, but they just pass it through the gut quickly and get the easy stuff, a lot like our catfish example earlier. So they only digest about 20% of the fiber from bamboo. The sharks are getting 52% of the fiber from seagrass. That's pretty good. Again, more on par with true omnivores than what we've seen otherwise. So they're doing pretty good. How about whether they can digest and assimilate the more labeled parts of the seagrass? So what Sam did is, you know, as the sharks were consuming this labeled seagrass over time, she drew blood from the sharks across a 3-week feeding trial, and we measured the isotopic signature of the blood over time. Okay, and so we have the squid down here with this dashed dot line. We have unlabeled seagrass with that dashed line. So like that's what seagrass looks like in nature. We have the label grass here, and that's the mean value in the total range of delta 13 C's in gray, in that gray box. Okay, and so you can see it's very positive. And it should also remind you that delta 13 C in nature tends to be negative, right? So when you label something, it gets this positive range, you have a strong signal there. Okay, so let's look at how the sharks changed over time. That's one shark with the blue circle. So by week 3, very labeled. That's the next one with the red, got the green, got the purple, and we got the yellow. So all 5 sharks by the end of the experiment were very labeled in terms of what was in their blood, right? So this is curious because some of these values are insanely high, right? Much higher than the mean value for the seagrass. And so there's a lot there. So that made us curious. Well, maybe some of the bicarbonate that we're adding in the water, you know, seagrass could just take up the bicarb directly and then that could end up in the sharks. So we wanted to make sure that was being assimilated into the tissue. So then we did compound specific stable isotope analysis on the seagrass food and on the liver. And so we have the delta 13C on the y-axis here, and we have our the bulk values and then all the amino acids down here on the x-axis. So the bulk liver is there with the black diamond. It's about 360 per mil, so very labeled, right? When you get into the seagrass, there's bulk seagrass in gray. That's the mean value. And then you get to the fiber that we extracted. We actually got the fiber out of the seagrass and we measured the isotopic signature just of that. And it's clearly labeled too, right? So the seagrass was clearly labeled beyond just some bicarbonate in there. The tissues itself are labeled. And when you break down the proteins that are present and start looking at them, comparing the liver to the seagrass, what you see is that you have a perfect match with all these amino acids on the left. So what we call essential amino acids they're getting from their food. Just after 3 weeks, they're already isotopically matched with what was in the seagrass, again, heavily labeled. And then the ones on the right are the non-essentials. And so the seagrass amino acids are a little more labeled. The livers aren't there yet, but they're kind of marching that way, clearly not displaying just what was in the squid or in unlabeled seagrass, for example. So those will eventually get there. Turnover times and livers can vary in sharks and be over a month. So, you know, you give these sharks another couple of weeks, they can get there where all the amino acids will be perfectly labeled. Bottom line is, this is evidence that they're definitely assimilating the protein, right? The amino acids from the seagrass, it's labeled and it's there. So yeah, they can definitely digest and assimilate this stuff. All right, and finally, mechanistically, you know, thinking about how are they doing this, and especially relating to fiber, there must be some microbial involvement, right? No vertebrate makes cellulase or anything like that. So we measured beta-glucosidase, which breaks down cellulose breakdown products. And indeed, we find a spike of that in the distal intestine, suggesting the microbial involvement with fiber digestion. And in a whole nother paper, we looked at microbial diversity and levels of fermentation and whatnot, all of which suggests there's definitely microbial activity there and they're likely contributing to the digestive process. So got lots of evidence there. Why does any of this matter? Well, seagrass beds are super important, right? They're all over the place. They provide important habitat, nursery habitat for a lot of fishery species that we depend on. They act as filters. They do a lot of different things. Seagrass meadows are super important. And when you look at their distribution globally, there's a lot. And so up to this point, in terms of managing these systems and thinking about who the major players are, we don't, and, you know, if we start modeling that and figuring out who we need to help manage, we don't think of sharks as being grazers or omnivores at all. But these data suggest, wow, they really are, you know, digesting a fair amount of grass. And if you, you know, look at the number of individuals just in the Gulf of Mexico, there's like 4 million bonnethead sharks, then, you know, relatively speaking, they're pretty large animals, about a meter long. You know, they're consuming a lot of grass. So now all of a sudden we have to start thinking about they're consuming a lot, they're actually digesting it, you know, in terms of dispersing nutrients and whatnot, they're definitely playing a different role than we thought, right? And we wouldn't have known that by just dismissing the seagrass as, oh, it's just incidental. And it might be incidental, really. They might just be crappy hunters. They get better with time, which is why they consume less seagrass as they get larger, right? The juveniles are the ones that consume the most. So they're really going after a crab or something, taking grass with it. But the gut is not ignoring it. And we would not have known that without really diving into that. So that again shows the importance of taking that gut-eyed view of their nutritional ecology. All right, I don't think this video is played. One other thing we were doing was getting into to CT scanning spiral intestines of sharks. You know, that video is not gonna work right now, but you can like fly through a psychedelic spiral looking at how this gut region works. And it's really cool. Basically, what it comes down to is these spiral intestines kind of work like natural Tesla valves, engendering one-way flow, even with muscular contractions in the gut. So beyond just increasing surface area, they definitely have these structures affect flow through these environments. So it's pretty neat stuff. And this is now in press at Proceedings of the Royal Society. All right, let's move along. Let's move on to now thinking about molecular stuff, underpinnings of digestive abilities. So the shark example is fun, shows a lot of different techniques we use, but I want to dig down in the molecular stuff. So in order to get into this work, it helps to think about the gut in terms of chemical reactor theory. So this is a silver side, a top smelt, and it eats algae, of course. and it eats algae, and then of course it's going to poop that out. And so what along the way, right, gets absorbed is a function of a lot of different things. So the digestibility side of this is proportional to what's going on in the gut in terms of biochemistry, right? The enzyme activity itself as a function of the substrate concentration. So thinking about kind of Michaelis-Menten kind of kinetics. So if you have a lot of a substrate present, if you don't also have a lot of the enzyme present, you're going to have low digestibility for that, right? So like what we saw with the wood-eating catfish, they ate a ton of cellulose, don't have much cellulase, so they didn't digest much of it. However, if you have a lot of starch, for example, and you have a lot of amylase, well, then you're going to digest a lot of it. And so that's kind of one of the things that informs our hypotheses that get generated relating gut function to diet, and also thinking about gut size. So gut size is that kind of moves as a function of motility. So how quickly is stuff moving through the gut? Again, if you have very rapid motility, so a large denominator there, you better have a big gut, right, to have high digestibility. Otherwise, you won't achieve what you're after. So again, looking at fish guts, you can see that, right? Animals that eat more plant material or more detritus, for example, they indeed have these longer guts, right? Fast motility, 4-hour transit times, your gut better be really long to make sure you can digest what you're taking in. So those kinds of things fit really well in terms of morphology. So let's focus in on the enzyme side of things. Okay, so what this kind of chemical reactor theory stuff predicts is that we should have a match basically between substrate concentration and enzyme activity in the diet. So more enzyme if more substrate. And so if you contrast herbivores and carnivores, herbivores are going to be eating a lot more carbs, right? Starch and fibrous cell walls, that's the real difference, right? There's not as much carb in animal material. Of course, there's a lot of difference in protein there, but all animals need protein. So that's tough, right? Because herbivores, I think, are still pretty darn efficient at digesting protein, but the carbs are the real difference there. And indeed, when you start looking at enzyme activities in guts, amylase is the one that jumps out. Okay, this is using that silver side example, that is a top smelt in the picture. So we have top smelt in an estuary where they're actually eating a lot of algae and terra morpha versus the same species, but out on the kelp forest at Newport Beach, where they eat more inverts, huge difference in amylase activity. And you compare that with other carnivorous silver sides, and you can see in the Jack smelt and Grunion also have low amylase. So we have tons of amylase in the animal eating more algae and therefore more starch. So we see that. You move right along to other examples. These are minnows. We have pretty much a carnivorous clade here in Nokomis, save one population in the Altamaha River drainage that's herbivorous, and then their sister to a whole group of herbivorous Campostoma. So when you look at amylase activity in these two groups, you see a very similar pattern where the herbivores all have really elevated amylase compared to those carnivores in the other clade. Again, except for that one population, you see it. These are literally the same species, right? Whatever a species is in freshwater because of allopatry. But point is the one eating a lot more algae, a lot more starch, has elevated amylase. So we see this kind of locking in across the board, not just in fish, but in lots of different animals. So amylase is clearly elevated in herbivores and omnivores. You can see it in birds, bats, primates, that's us, right? And in dogs versus wolves. There's a massive difference there between dogs and wolves. And one of the major differences when you do genome, when you look at like GWAS analyses, is dogs are really good at digesting starch and dealing with glucose, and wolves aren't. And that's because we've been throwing dogs, you know, starchy scraps for about 10,000 years. So they got pretty good at it. So this is the bird example showing amylase activity contrast as a function of the dietary starch contrast. So the evolution of each are highly correlated. The more starch in a bird's diet, the higher amylase activity they have in an evolutionary context. And in humans, if you come from an agrarian background, if you've been basically evolved from humans who grew grains, you have a lot more copies of amylase in your genome than folks who didn't, right? So we have a Japanese individual on the top here, and they have 16 copies of amylase in their genome. An individual from the Byakka tribe only has 6. And then our most closely related primate and a relative who doesn't eat much in the way of starch, a chimp, only has 2 copies. So humans have had a massive increase in gene copy number for amylase to increase their ability to digest starch. And so it's pretty well documented. So we're seeing this kind of across the board, right? That carbs in the main signal in the gut that are driving these enzyme signals. But what are the genetic mechanisms? Is it always about gene copy number, right? And furthermore, what are the consequences of this? Like, we can wave our hand and suggest that gave some sort of advantage to individuals who could digest this stuff better. And in fact, right now it might be making us sick because now we're eating so much processed carb and we're already really good at digesting this stuff, but that's not good. But what are the, you know, the real consequences of what's going on at the molecular level leading to enzyme activities in the gut? And so to investigate that, we look at this in prickleback fishes, which are common to our coast here. We have two herbivores up top there, Cebodictes violaceus and Zyphistra mucosus. And then we have an omnivore Zyphistra atropius and a carnivore Anaplarcus purpurescens. And Phytichthys chirus is also another major player that we examine. That's an omnivore. So purple for omnivory, blue herbivory, red carnivory. We get them on the central coast here in California, beautiful intertidal sites, low tide, you can go out and get them. They don't go out with the water, so you can go out and get them with the dip net at low tide. And you can see they really live in environments with lots of algal cover. So plenty of algae abundant in their environment, and they're all sympatric, so they're really easy to get all from the same site. When you look at their evolutionary relationships, you can see that Cebodictes violaceus is up here in this clade, where they are the only herbivore represented in that clade. And you come down here and follow up to where the Zyphisters are. They're a part of this clade with Phytichthys chirus, where they're nothing but omnivores or herbivores, which is cool. So we have a nice stepwise progression here from omnivory to herbivory. And we have sister taxa, of course, with different diets. So that gives us an opportunity to look at, you know, how different are sister taxa in terms of adaptations for diet. And then Anaplarcus purpurescens is a carnivore down here, and they're really more representative of kind of the typical stachyid feeding mode in terms of being carnivorous. So it's a great system to better understand what are the genetic underpinnings of digestive specialization and what does it mean to the animal. And the phylogeny is put together by Michelle and Abe. And so that's why I put them there. Michelle's, you know, a PhD student in my lab now. Okay, so when we look at their guts, we indeed see higher amylase activity in the herbivores in blue and the omnivores, except for P. chirus. They don't have really elevated amylase. And then our carnivores down here. So we do see that same pattern I already showed you in other animals of more elevated amylase in animals eating more starch. And when you compare P. chirus to X. atropius as omnivores, these guys eat more algae than they do. It's just that these two are like eat lots more algae. Okay, so we definitely have elevated amylase in them. So Joseph Eros came into the lab as a postdoc and sequenced the genome of Cebodictes violaceus, and we also have transcriptomes from the other fish. So we're going to start comparing the genetics of kind of, you know, amylase adaptation, if you will, for different diets, and put together a great genome with a contig size of 6.7 megabases, the second largest of any fish up to that point. Only X. maculatus, Xiphophorus had a basically bigger sequences and a very, very well represented genome. So we're able to really work with this resource to look at what's there. And so when you start digging into the chromosomes and seeing what's there, you can see Cebodictes has two copies of what's called amylase 2A, and they have a third one of 2B. And there's a transposase here that suggests that there's probably TEs, transposable elements, involved with expanding gene copy number in these genes. So that's cool. But, and then, you know, we wanted to be sure because these two copies of 2A, I pointed at my screen with a pen, that doesn't help, right? These two copies of 2A are identical. So when you're assembling your genome, the assembly doesn't like the fact that you're trying to say, these are two separate things, I'm gonna condense them into one, because they're actually different. So that's where it helps that we did not just Illumina sequencing, but PacBio sequencing with long reads, because we're really confident that we have lots of spanning reads in this region, right? And that's what this is showing. It's just this is called a canoe assembly, showing that we have lots of reads spanning that region. And we can be confident that we definitely have two copies of AME2A, and it's not just an assembly issue. So that was really key there. Okay, and then we can also detect them using polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. So we can see Amy2A in all the species. And what's interesting, we're running that at pH 7. So these migratory patterns are really a function of their isoelectric points, not the size. Their sizes are all really similar. So these aren't migrating on size, they're migrating on charge, basically. And so that's really cool. So we see Amy2A is really easy to see. Amy2B, not so much. So we actually had to run at a different pH. We included porcine as a control. We don't even see them because they run off the gel in the opposite direction. Same for P. chiris. But for because of the isoelectric point is 8.62 for Amy2B and subadignes, we can actually detect both of those. So we know they're both being expressed. We can use qPCR and show both genes are being expressed. We also did it with transcriptomics. So everything's there. We know they're expressing both amylases and both proteins are present. So therefore, Amy or subadictes has different genetics going on basically than the other fish do. Then they only have Amy2A. So then you get into, well, maybe they're better at digesting certain starches than the other ones are. So we tried that. We compared the two herbivores, Sebadictes violaceus and Xiphus tumicosus. We have amylase activity on the y-axis and different types of starches on the x. They're both pretty bad at digesting amylose, which is funny because the name of the enzyme is amylase, but they're all equally good at digesting kind of potato, corn, and amylopectin. So even though Sebadictes has this extra copy of amylase, right, Amy2B, it's no better at digesting different starches than X-mucosis with only Amy2A, okay? So that's kind of interesting. We also looked at kind of other aspects of it in terms of like pH, optimality and all that. There's really not a whole lot of differences there. In terms of digestibility, so this is like looking at more of the whole animal level, when you give them porphyra versus mosiella versus ulva, which is the main algal taxa that they consume, Sebadictes might be slightly better at digesting porphyra, and that's about it, right? That's this middle one here. So maybe Sebadictes with Amy2B is slightly better at getting some of the starches from red algae compared to Xiphus tumicosus. And that may be just that's it. That's the only advantage it might provide. Otherwise, we can't really detect much. And so when you come back and look at this, you say, okay, well, Sebadictes evolved in this separate clade. They evolved herbivory on their own. So we have convergent evolution of herbivory here between these two species, you know, separately. And so, you know, this one has done it one way and the other one has done it another. So what does it mean, you know, in terms of this one species having more copies of it and a different gene? What it means to us is there's more than one way to skin a cat, right? The phenotype is there in terms of having elevated amylase. How they achieved that phenotype was different because they evolved separately, right? But at the end of the day, they have a very similar phenotype. There's different underpinnings, but we don't know what that even means because they're both seem to be just as efficient as the other in terms of digesting starches. So it's kind of a neat evolutionary example of conversion evolution, solving a problem a different way, but overall it works. There's been several good examples of that recently with E. coli, for example, in experimental evolution. All right, one quick example of relating to what happens if you have a substrate that's not that common, right? What if this is a low number? Well, that would seem to suggest you wouldn't need much activity to get digestibility, but what if that substrate is an essential nutrient, right? So what if it's low and it's a limiting nutrient? And this is where lipids come to mind, right? There's a lot of essential fatty acids that animals have to get from their food. And algae are notoriously low in lipid, like five or less than 10%, like 5% range in terms of lipid by mass. So algae are low, I mean, diatoms notwithstanding, right? But these we're talking about macroalgae. Interestingly, when you look at lipolytic activity in the guts, the fish, Sebadictes and Xiphus are pretty high, right? They have really elevated lipase, in compared to the other hardcore like omnivore and the carnivore. This carnivore is getting a lot more lipid than all of them, and yet their activity is much lower. And so we dug into that, and very interestingly, this is looking at that, I know it's a little blurry and I apologize, but you can see the teal color here. They have four copies, Sebadictes does, of bile salt activated lipase. Whereas other fish with really good genomes, we can only find two. So most of the time they have two copies, Sebadictes has four. Again, they have elevated lipase activities. And when you get into kind of looking at selection on genes and whatnot, there's some interesting things going on with lipases in the animals eating more algal material. So this is very interesting to us because that suggests that animals eating algae are investing more in these lipases. Lipids are already hard to get from the food. And so they actually have the signatures of investing in that to get it. So what does that mean for potentially like aquaculture? Is that if we want to start thinking about sustainable aquaculture and growing animals that eat more plants as opposed to using fish meal to feed like things right now, like we do with salmon and whatnot, we need to find animals that can actually make a living on that, especially the lipids. When you try to feed plant material, especially the lipids, to salmon and other carnivores, they don't deal well with those, right? Again, Anaplarca has had really low lipase activity, right? So carnivorous animals don't do well with plant lipids. So we need to find herbivorous animals that do well with these plant lipids. And it looks like Sebedictes is doing just fine, right? And they have actually expanded gene copy number in this ability to digest the lipids. So we feel like this is a way forward for sustainable aquaculture, is to find those animals that digest the plant lipids well and focus on those. Either culture those animals directly, or we can make GMO salmon, for example, that are really good at digesting plant lipids. And here's the architecture for that, right? So there's different ways of looking at that. There's actually a group at Moss Landing right now who's trying to start a Sebedictes aquaculture because they do taste very good and they get quite large. Just to point out, we have seen this before in a feeding trial with zebrafish, where we fed them a high fiber diet in the lab. And when you feed them a high fiber diet versus, you know, omnivore and carnivore diets, the big things that pop out as changing the most, gut size and lipase. Those are the big things that change the most on the high fiber diet. Lipase went up a lot. Fiber binds to fat. So if fiber binds to fat, it makes it harder to digest. And so the fish literally were investing in more lipase to even get the fat that was there. So we feel like that's some of the aspect of what's going on with herbivores as well. And nature is having elevated lipase, is that they're making sure they get that limiting nutrient right from their food. But then of course, the types of lipids matter too. All right, I'm gonna skip over this in the interest of time. At the end though, if you want me to talk about this cool transcriptomic result, I totally wanna talk about it. But let's go jump into some aspects of microbiome. If I have time, I'll talk about this, the prickleback example with Michelle and her data, but I really wanna start with the lizard example because that's really exciting. So this is a study done by Dr. Beck Worley a few years ago. He was a former PhD student in the lab. So he worked on Podarcus siculus, which is this lizard that is native to the Mediterranean. And so it lived out on these islands, and they transferred 5 breeding pairs back in the 70s from one island to another. I don't know if I have the map. I don't. So it doesn't matter. They moved them from one little island to another, let them go. They did an invasion study. I guess the 70s were a wild time. So this group from Belgium comes back, Belgium and France comes back, you know, 40 years later, and is like, what happened to those animals they moved? And they found that the ones they moved to the new island, which was Podmacharu, started eating a crap ton of plant material, right? So like 60% of the mass of their intake was plant material compared to the source population on Podkopiste. And so Podkopiste wasn't eating a whole lot of plants. Interestingly enough, in that short period of time, the hindguts of the lizard started to develop valves or baffles, almost like what you see in an iguana gut. So we're talking like, you know, 30 generations or so, a lizard going from a hindgut that looks like this, just like a large voluminous large intestine, if you will, to having these valves there to help control flow. And that's amazing. That's really fast, right? And so this really caught the eye of a lot of folks. And this is Anthony Harrell, who was the lead author on that paper. And so that was really exciting to see. And so Beck started studying the digestive physiology of these lizards, looking at, you know, all aspects of their physiology. And so this is the freshly dissected lizards from the two islands. Gut size isn't that different. You know, we looked at lots of different things, but where the differences lie are in the hindgut. Okay, there's definitely differences in enzyme activities in the hindgut, and there's differences in the microbial community. And again, this is what the histology looks like. So those kind of baffles you see, the valves, if you will, are just protruding from the wall of the gut. Interestingly enough, when you looked at the microbial communities in these hindgut regions, and you compare the source insectivorous population to the newly omnivorous population, there's some major differences. The big ones that jump out are methanobrevibacter, which is actually an archaean. So that is pretty much absent, and the source population is now really abundant in Padmucharu. They really help with generating substrates for fermentation by other microbial other microbes. In terms of acromantia, when you have low acromantia, that's actually a signature of like the obese microbiome in humans. So low acromantia tends to indicate a community that's getting more energy from their food than they probably should be. But it makes sense if you're an omnivorous lizard living a hard life, trying to scrape a living, that you would have a microbial community that's giving you some extra stuff, right? And so that's really interesting, the acromantia was so low. And then Pepto-streptococcaceae is another major player here. And they seem to really help with protein scavenging and trypsin activities. Trypsin's a protease is one of the major differences going on in the hindguts between the insectivorous and omnivorous lizards. So lots of cool stuff borne out on the community level that we also see effects of when you start measuring enzyme activities and fermentation. So it's really exciting kind of work there. All right, I have more microbiome things to share on pricklebacks and whatnot, but I'm gonna go ahead and stop here because, well, I'm out of time and I want to have time for questions. So I really thank you for paying attention. I hope I didn't bore you to death. And please ask questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. German, for that really interesting talk. Yes, just a reminder, you can ask your questions in the Q&A box. I actually have a question maybe while people are typing theirs. When you mentioned the three gene copies of the amylase genes, is there any cost to that kind of duplication or not?
That's a great question. So one thing I didn't explain maybe very well was when you have more copies of a gene and they're active copies, right? So you're gonna express more of that. So you're gonna make more of the protein. Right, and there's good evidence of that. So usually an increase in gene copy number, especially when they're all expressed, means more of the enzyme. So yeah, there probably is more of a cost there to generate more of that protein. So it has to usually match. And that's the usual argument of what's called the adaptive modulation hypothesis, right? It's like an economics argument. You're not gonna make so much of something that you don't need. It's really wasteful to do that, especially when you're competing for membrane space or anything like that. So the original hypothesis was really thinking about kind of disaccharidases taking up room on microvilli, and that how you, there's no way in heck you'd have too much of something that you just don't need, but it's really borne out with amylase. And I think, yeah, there's gotta be a cost to making more of it, but clearly there's a benefit by making sure you're getting that starch, because there, I think that's what most of their ATP synthesis is probably coming from, that starch. So should I stop sharing so I can see the chat?
Yeah, I can see it too on my end. But if you want to see it too, you can stop sharing. Sure.
Not sure if there's other participants as part of that. Is that one individual, Coastal Marine Sciences Institute, or is there like a lot of individuals there?
I think that's just one.
Okay, individual. So it's just the two of us then.
I think there's other people. They're just not showing up as Zoom boxes.
Oh, I see it. Yeah, because there are 22 participants. Yeah. Got it. Yeah, don't be afraid to ask questions. I see, we're just the panelists. That's why that's only showing up. There we go.
Oh yeah, so I don't know if you can see the questions, but somebody asked, said off the subject, are your studies being replicated for humans?
Oh, good question. So in terms of, yeah, I mean, there's work being done on rodent and humans as well, right? Rodent models and humans. It's hard to do what we're doing, like with multiple species in the same environment, you know, we've killed off all of our closest living relatives, so we can't do that with humans, right? So that there's good work being done, like looking at, for example, family lineages and whatnot, in humans and in rodent models as well. So you could say, yeah, I mean, there's similar lines being pursued, but maybe motivated by different types of questions. And I see that one from Jeremiah. Are there other enzymes besides amylases that are important? Yeah, I mean,
Dr. German is frozen on my screen. I don't know if he's frozen on anybody else's.
Okay. Yeah, cool. Looks like we lost him for a little bit there. So we'll give him another minute. Hopefully he comes back and can answer some final questions before too.
I disappeared for a second, but I'm back. So anyway, to answer that question, amylase is probably the one that's most well studied, but certainly others can play a role. Like I was saying with that pepto-streptococcaceae, being more abundant, correlating with more trypsin activity in the hindgut of the lizards, that seemed to suggest maybe some more protein scavenging being aided by that microbial community. So I feel like there's a lot of work to be done there. Right, host-wise, I'm very interested in lipids though. Okay, I see that. That one, we see no one else. Let's see. In what ways do you consider the changing partitioning of compounds in algae and plants from ocean acidification when you think about energy costs, digestion, or the consumer? That's a great question. So I don't know. It could be, right, obviously, let's just focus on temperature. So if you have elevated temperature, you have elevated metabolic rate. So you got to generate just more ATP in general, right? So I would think that an animal that's really reliant on soluble carbs to get their energetics going would probably still invest in those carbohydrates to make sure they're getting enough there. And of course, it would depend on the types of algae they're consuming. That would affect the different types of carbohydrates that would be expressed. And then thinking about protein, that's probably always important. So I feel like protein, for the most part, those enzyme proteases are pretty much always upregulated. And if you look at herbivorous guts, they tend to be larger, and you look at the amount of protein there, they're cranking out more proteases per day than the carnivores are. And I think they're trying to scavenge all that protein that's there. But this is kind of, that one's well known. The lipid side of it is more different. And so being warmer could do things to your membranes. Oops, sorry, I threw my pen. Could do things to your membranes to maybe make lipid acquisition more important too. So kind of, I guess, talking through that, I would think all of the nutrients probably start to matter as you warm up.
Maybe we have time for one more question from Alyssa. I don't know if you can see it on your end, but it might be frozen. Why not?
I think we lost Donovan again.
Okay, yeah. Well, it's 2:00, so I guess thank you everybody for coming. I hope you enjoyed this talk, and I hope you have a great rest of your week. So thank you.